So I'm Dr. Pat Vickers. I have a clinic in Mexico. We also have a law in the United States that says that we cannot claim to be curing cancer or treating cancer. Is this thing dying? We have the same law. We have the same law stating that we cannot cure, we cannot treat cancer with nutrition. And so the way you get around that, you say we're successfully treating advanced disease. So we have a clinic in Mexico where we're reversing virtually every single degenerative disease using nutrition. Virtually every single degenerative disease. The only ones we really have trouble curing are the blood cancers and then Parkinson's. Apart from that, we're reversing virtually every single condition using nutrition. You're about to hear, this is going in now. Somebody know how to check the battery on this? Or no? You're about to hear one of the greatest stories and tragedies, certainly in medical history, if not human history. And it's the story of Dr. Max Gerson, who to this day, 57 years after his death, remains the most censored doctor in the history of medicine. I had the privilege of living with Dr. Gerson's family, particularly Charlotte Gerson, his last living daughter. And it's because of that that I have this clinic today in Mexico, where we're using the Gerson therapy as the foundation of reversing virtually every single disease. So this story truly is one of the greatest tragedies that you'll ever hear. Because Dr. Gerson was successfully reversing these diseases between 1910 and 1959 when he died. So how can we be reversing these diseases for nearly 100 years and you've never heard about it in the mainstream media? I'm going to spend about 20 to 30 minutes going through the historical and political ramifications of my work. And then after that, we're going to dive deep into the science behind how we're reversing advanced terminal disease. By the time you leave here, it'll be very clear what the causes of disease are and how you cure it. It'll be crystal clear. Okay, title of the lecture is The American Experience of Max Gerson, Censored for Curing Cancer. So the question remains, why haven't you heard of it? Nobel Peace Prize winner Dr. Albert Schweitzer, who's considered the greatest Christian of his generation, he knew Dr. Gerson personally. They were best friends. He said, I see in Dr. Max Gerson one of the most eminent geniuses in medical history. 8 years before Schweitzer won the Nobel Prize, he had severely advanced diabetes. Dr. Gerson cured him in 6 weeks. Schweitzer's wife, Helena, and you can read about this in Schweitzer's biographies. Schweitzer's wife, Helena, had terminal tuberculosis. She had 3 months to live with holes in her lungs the size of golf balls, and Dr. Gerson completely cured her. And their daughter, Raina, who was actually good friends with Charlotte growing up, they were about the same age, she had an undecipherable skin condition. And Dr. Gerson also cured her. If you ever get the chance to read Dr. Schweitzer's eulogy upon hearing about Dr. Gerson's sudden and suspicious death, it'll absolutely bring tears to your eyes because of what Dr. Gerson meant just to Dr. Schweitzer's family alone. So using the same treatment, he cured diabetes, tuberculosis, and an undecipherable skin condition that their daughter had when she was 4 years old, all using the same treatment. People say, well, everybody's different, so everybody needs a different protocol. My disease is different. No, it's not. Cancer is cancer is cancer. Skin conditions are skin conditions are skin conditions. There's no difference. Your liver doesn't function any different than mine. Your kidneys don't function any different than mine. And so the protocols are essentially the same. Very rarely when you come to our clinic are our protocols tailored. They're pretty much standard and universal across the board. So Nobel Peace Prize winner Albert Schweitzer, called Dr. Gerson one of the greatest geniuses in medical history. You might know this gentleman, Prince Charles of Wales. He's one of our greatest advocates living today. Sting, from the Police, being the other. Sting donates. Sting's wife, Trudy, donates thousands of dollars to the Gerson therapy. Can we check this out? Is this okay? I mean, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, good.
All right.
Never mind then. Prince Charles of Wales. I know one patient who turned to the Gerson therapy having been told that she was suffering from terminal cancer and would not survive another course of chemotherapy. Happily, 7 years later, she's alive and well, so it's therefore vital that rather than dismissing such experiences, we should further investigate the beneficial nature of these treatments. He said this before the Royal Society of Gynecologists and Obstetricians on an international stage. This never made it out into the international press except for one newspaper for one day. It never made it into the international press. Where did it end up? It ended up for one day in the Danish national newspaper. And then they took it off the rack. And so this is the problem today. We like to think we live in the day of information where everything we need to know is at our fingertips. We just Google it into the search engine of the internet. And all of a sudden, all this information we need is going to pop up. But the reality is, the internet, it's more designed to confuse and it's designed to give you the truth. If you Google the cure for cancer, do you think the Gerson therapy is going to pop up? If you Google the Gerson therapy, do you know what pops up? All these pharmaceutical and medical websites telling you how we've never cured one case of cancer. Not one case of cancer, which is an outright lie. We've cured thousands upon thousands. It's indisputable that we're reversing these advanced diseases. So why haven't you heard of it? The reality is, we get 99.9% of our information from the mainstream media. That's where it comes from. Who's the mainstream media dominated by? The pharmaceutical and the medical industry. That's who it's dominated by. Anybody been to the United States and watched TV in the United States? When you go, what are you bombarded with all night long? Whether it's the newspaper, the TV, the radio, the magazine, you're bombarded with drug advertisements. The pharmaceutical industry in the United States, they spend over $150 billion per year just to advertise their toxic pharmaceutical drugs. $150 billion. So if you're an editor of any major media outlet in the United States and really around the world, because governments are supported by the pharmaceutical and the medical industry, all governments. The only place where they essentially aren't right now is Southeast Asia. So, if you're an editor of any of these major media outlets, your sole fiscal responsibility is to promote the financial interests of your organization. It has nothing to do with giving you or I the truth. And so that's why you will never hear about the Gerson therapy in the mainstream media, ever. You'll never hear about it. Here's the quote. This is a quote from John Swinton, former chief and staff and senior editor of the New York Times. Now, this is before his retirement dinner, before the Manhattan Press Club. So all the premier journalists in the world are attending his retirement dinner. And he's asked to stand up and toast a free press. Now, he's retired. He can say whatever he wants. And this is what he said. There is no such thing at this date of the world's history in America as an independent press. You know it, and I know it. There's not one of you who dares to write your honest opinions, and if you did, you know beforehand that it would never appear in print. I'm paid weekly for keeping my honest opinion out of the paper I'm connected with. Others of you are paid similar salaries for similar things, and any of you who would be so foolish as to write your honest opinions would be out on the streets looking for another job. If I allowed my honest opinions to appear in one issue of my paper, before 24 hours, my occupation would be gone. The business of the journalist is to destroy the truth, to lie outright, to pervert, to vilify, to fawn at the feet of mammon, and to sell his country and his race for his daily bread. You know it, and I know it. And what folly is this, toasting an independent press? We are the tools and vassals of rich men behind the scenes. We are the jumping jacks, they pull the strings, and we dance. Our talents, our possibilities, and our lives are the property of other men. We are intellectual prostitutes. And that's the reality. So let's test out his theory. 1946. This is the first time you had the opportunity to hear about Dr. Gerson and that the cure for cancer had been found. 1946, the Pepper-Neely Anti-Cancer Bill comes to the United States Senate. It's designed to give $100 million in funding to anyone who could show promise in the realm of cancer research. Well, somebody in the Senate had heard that Dr. Gerson was reversing advanced terminal cancer, so they asked him to testify July 1st through the 3rd, 1946. Dr. Gerson brought five of his most terminal cancer patients that he had ever had, and all five walked through Senate chambers doors and they testified before the United States Senate. So shocked was everybody in that room that Senator Claude Pepper himself, who sponsored the bill, said Dr. Gerson dedicated his life to the mastery of this scourge of cancer, and all should honor his great work. The sponsor of the bill said that. So what happened? Why didn't this come out in the international press? Because when something of this magnitude happens in Senate chambers, the press is all over it. So Dr. Gerson was whisked away to the international press room where he was supposed to give an interview to the international press. And he sat there for an hour and a half and nobody showed up. He sat alone in a room for an hour and a half. The international press had been whisked away to another room and an impromptu party was thrown on their behalf. Compliments of the pharmaceutical and the medical industry and our politicians. They refused to allow Dr. Gerson to be interviewed. Luckily, you see that name there, Raymond Graham Swing? Who's Raymond Graham Swing? Well, back then we didn't have TVs. So if you wanted to listen to the news every night, you sat around your radio at 7 o'clock at night and you had three choices. You could listen to ABC News, CBS, or NBC. CBS, their anchor man who gave you the news every night was Edwin Murrow, very famous man in the United States. I'm not sure who the person was doing NBC News back then, but Raymond Graham Swing had been working for ABC News Radio for 30 years, and he was the person you listened to every night on ABC News broadcast as he gave the news 7 p.m. every night. Well, he was present at Dr. Gerson's testimony, and when he went on his radio broadcast that night, the first thing he said was, "Folks, please forgive me if I don't talk about everything going on in the world today," which I think the Truman Anti-Racketeering Bill had been signed. I think something involving the Treaty of Trieste or World War II had happened or had been signed at that point. So those news stories would have covered the entire hour. But he said, "But what I heard today behind closed doors of the Senate chambers is the most shocking information that the world needs to know, that the cure for cancer has been found." Raymond Graham Swing publicly stated that the cure for cancer had been found. So he spent the next 45 minutes talking about what he heard from Dr. Gerson behind Senate chambers doors. And for 9 hours straight after he finished, the switchboards at ABC News Radio in New York lit up from people all over the world trying to find out where to get this cure for cancer. For 9 hours straight, the ABC switchboards were completely full. Well, 2 weeks later, after 30 years at ABC News Radio, Raymond Graham Swing was fired from his job. Because even back then, ABC News Radio was receiving $100 million a year from the medical and pharmaceutical industry to promote their toxic drugs and their other business interests. So it's a reality, and the same thing happens today. It's no different today. If you're an editor, just as John Swinton said, if you're an editor or a journalist, you're gone if you interrupt the financial interests of your organization. That document, by the way, Dr. Gerson's word-for-word testimony, is in the United States National Archives. You ever been to D.C.? Anybody here been to Washington, D.C.? Well, it's right there on Capitol Mall, between the Capitol and the Washington Monument. The National Archives building is right there, document number 8947. 1986, that was the second time you had the chance to hear about Dr. Gerson, and the last time. Under increasing pressure from the American public to look into alternative treatments? The United States Congress was forced into an investigation of alternative treatments. So the Office of Technological Assessment, which is the investigative branch of the United States Congress, they were called upon to investigate 13 different therapies that have a reputation of being able to help people with advanced disease. The premier one being the Gerson therapy, hands down. Well, one of my friends, Gar Hildenbrand, was asked to sit as the expert for the Gerson therapy, as the Gerson therapy was one of those 13. So what they did, they set up a panel. That panel was made up of a woman named Helen Gelband. Helen Gelband was a known pharmaceutical and medical crony. So she's going to control all the information with her three colleagues who also sat on the panel. And they're going to take the information coming in from the people they contract to study the Gerson therapy. So they contacted this woman named Patricia Spain Ward, and they asked her to investigate the Gerson therapy. Why did they pick Patricia Spain Ward, one of the most renowned medical journalists in U.S. history? They asked her to do it because years earlier, she'd written a scathing expose about a guy named Andrew Ivey who claimed he was curing advanced terminal cancer with his drug called Crebiotsin. And what she discovered after all her investigation was that it was all a lie. So they figured they were going to get the same out of her regarding the Gerson therapy. So when Helen Gelband approached her to investigate the Gerson therapy, Patricia Spain Ward understood very clearly the politics behind natural treatment in the United States. And she believed in it, secretly. And so she told Helen Gelband privately, she said, okay, I'll study your Gerson therapy. Only if you promise that whatever I write, good or bad, in my final report, that every single word that I write makes it into the final draft of your investigation. And Helen Gelband looked her in the eyes and said, it's a deal, I promise. Well, if you Google Patricia Spain Ward's expose on the Gerson therapy, she emphatically stated that Dr. Gerson's story was one of the biggest tragedies in American history. Because Dr. Gerson was reversing virtually every single disease. And in her investigation, that's what she discovered. When the final draft came out, nothing from Patricia Spain Ward's expose made it into the final draft. And my friend Gar Hildenbrand and Patricia Spain Ward were on the phone together waiting for the release of the final results of this investigation into all these therapies. And the Washington Post was the first newspaper to release the final results. And they said after an exhausting investigation into alternative natural therapies for the treatment of cancer, it has been revealed that none of these therapies can show any efficacy in the treatment and reversal of advanced disease. So Patricia Spain Ward, on the phone with my friend Gar, she said she literally went into her bathroom and nearly vomited. Because she knew the implications of her expose in that final draft and what it meant to humanity and what it meant to the Gerson therapy becoming known and mainstream. So that's the reality. That's the situation we're faced with in the United States and around the world. Last thing here. We talk about all these things being conspiracy theory, right? Well, they're not. This is all real. There's no conspiracy behind it. 1987, there's a court case called the AMA versus Wilk. Now I'm a chiropractor. You know how many billions of dollars we steal from the medical and pharmaceutical industry, preventing people from taking unnecessary drugs and surgery just because of what we can do with our hands? And so we're a major threat to the chiropractic or to the medical industry. We're a huge threat. So in 1987, four chiropractors take the entire American Medical Association to court, accusing them of having a branch within their organization designed to eliminate chiropractic as a profession. They literally had a propaganda office machine designed to eliminate chiropractic as a profession. How many times have you heard that, oh, don't go to a chiropractor, they're quacks? Have you heard that?
Yes.
Do you know why you've heard that? From this. The American Medical Association's propaganda machine from the 1960s to the 1980s until this court case. So four chiropractors took them to court because we are a licensed profession. We're doctors in the United States. We are on the same level as a medical doctor in the United States. We're a licensed profession. So a federal district court judge in the United States, Susan Getzendaner, found the AMA guilty of conspiracy, conspiring to eliminate a licensed profession. And the ramifications of that propaganda office and machine that they had sit in your minds today, that chiropractors are quacks. When on the contrary, what we can do for people just with our hands to get them well. So, that's the judgment, guilty of conspiracy. So it's no longer conspiracy theory, it's conspiracy fact. Okay, we're gonna talk about Dr. Gerson and go straight into the therapy. Who was he? He was born in Wormwood, Germany in 1881. When he graduated from high school, in order to get into university back at that time, you had to pass an exit exam out of high school. And that got you into university if you pass it. Well, on his calculus exam, on the calculus portion of that exam, his calculus professor put a question on there that he'd never seen before. But he managed to come up with such an elaborate solution that his calculus teacher could not even tell him if it was right or wrong. Seriously. And she sent it to all the top university math professors in Germany at that time. And every single math professor wrote back saying that we have a mathematical genius in our country. And they all tried to recruit him for math. And when this happened, his entire family had a meeting at their home. Aunts, uncles, cousins, brothers, sisters, mother, father, they all met at Gerson's home. 18-year-old Dr. Gerson. Not a doctor yet, obviously. And they all discussed what he should study when he goes into university because they immediately recognized they had something very special on their hands. And so they all discussed what he should do when he goes into university, and they all said he should study medicine because that's where he would have the greatest impact on humanity. They felt that if he studied mathematics, he'd be stuck at some university behind a cubicle, and it wouldn't have much of an impact on the world. And they said he should study medicine. So he goes to the University of Freiburg, and while he's studying medicine, he's suffering from severe migraine headaches. So severe that he'd have to lock himself in a dark room for 2 to 3 days at a time. And these are the top university professors in the world in Germany at that time. If you wanted a superior medical education at that time, you went to Germany. And his professors couldn't do anything for him. So he set out to cure himself, and how did he cure himself? He eliminated all the garbage that was in the standard German diet at that time that's in our diet today. All the salt, sugars, fats, all the processed foods. And what did he do? He fed himself nothing but a fruit and vegetable vegetarian diet and cured himself of his migraine headaches. So when he graduates, he opens up a clinic in Bielefeld, Germany. And he starts using this migraine diet on his patients. When one of them comes back to him completely cured of their skin tuberculosis. Completely cured. And so he starts treating tuberculosis, and he starts curing all these tuberculosis patients. Now this is at a time when tuberculosis was ravaging through Europe, killing millions of people. And so a guy by the name of Ferdinand Sauerbruch, who was the world's leading thoracic surgeon in Europe at that time, he was the one operating on all these TB patients. Well, he gets word that this guy named Dr. Gerson is reversing advanced terminal tuberculosis. So he approaches Dr. Gerson and asks him if he'd be willing to embark on a study of advanced tuberculosis patients. And he told Dr. Gerson privately, he said, if you cure but one case of tuberculosis, I'll believe everything you say. Well, Dr. Gerson, on a study of 460 advanced tuberculosis patients, Gerson cured 451. And so at that time, the cure for tuberculosis had been announced throughout Europe. Today, there's still no cure for tuberculosis. It's been kept from us. So when Hitler comes to power, Gerson was a German Jew. He lost his entire family in the Holocaust. All his parents, all his brothers and sisters, he lost his entire family. And he himself escaped death on a train. He was on his way to lecture in Austria when the SS stopped his train. And they forgot to ask him for his ID because he distracted them by throwing up two x-rays, a before and an after x-ray of a tuberculosis patient that he had cured, and then he told them he was on his way to Austria. He's losing his luster here. So he nearly died on his way to lecture in Austria, but they forgot to ask him for his ID. And immediately when that happened and he escaped, he moved to France, and then from France, he moved to the United States. Now in the US, he set up practice in Manhattan, and there was a woman who had terminal stomach cancer and gallbladder cancer. Stomach, liver, and gallbladder cancer. Terminal. And she approached Dr. Gerson because she heard that he was in the country. And she begged him for his tuberculosis treatment, and he refused. Why do you think he refused? Because he understood the political ramifications of treating cancer in the United States with nutrition even back then in the 1930s. So she came to him like four or five times. She pressured him into giving him this tuberculosis treatment, and he refused. And finally, like on the fifth time, he agreed to treat her in secret, and he completely cured her of her terminal advanced cancer. Completely cured her. It was at that time he said, I dedicate my life to this therapy, or to this treatment of cancer. He couldn't turn his face away anymore from treating cancer. And from that time on, he dedicated the rest of his life to treating advanced cancer. And so here we are today, 70 years after his death, talking about the man who was reversing advanced terminal disease. Up until his death, he had lost his medical license. He had lost his membership in the New York State Medical Society. Up until he testified before the United States Senate in 1946, the most published doctor in the world. And then he was prohibited from publishing after that. He published in like two very minor journals around the world after that, because in all major medical journals, he was prohibited. So let's talk about the cause of disease. I'm going to read to you a couple quotes here. These are from very famous authors writing about the causes of disease. One of them is from a book called Genome. In this book, these gentlemen, J.E. Bishop and M. Waldholz, they say aberrant genes do not in and of themselves cause disease. By and large, their impact on an individual's health is minimal until the person is plunged into a harmful environment. And then a very famous author in the United States, Jeffrey Bland, he authored a book called Genetic Nutritioneering. He said, disease in most cases results when the individual elects a lifestyle or diet that alters the expression of genes in such a way that the weakness or uniqueness of inheritance factors results in a phenotype or a gene expression that we call disease. So what's the point here? The point here is, what we're being told today, that genes are the cause of disease, that's not true. What they're trying to tell you is, by the genes being the cause of disease, that you're doomed to get it due to familial factors, due to the genetic familiar factors that run in your family. Nothing could be further from the truth. What runs in families, folks? It's not genes. In 1900, one out of every 100 people got cancer. Now it's one out of every three. Genes have nothing to do with, genes don't change that rapidly. It has nothing to do with genes. What's happened between 1900 and now? The Industrial Revolution. The Industrial Revolution has poisoned us. It's belched every poison into our air, our water, our food, and it has absolutely nothing to do with genetics. What runs in families, folks, isn't genes. It's habits. It's the food you drink, the food you eat, the water you drink, the air you breathe, the stress factors, the relationships. Those are all the causes of disease. And these things, the poisons in our food, our water, our air, they have the ability to alter our genetic expression. Where the only thing that becomes a factor in genetics is you might be prone familial to prostate cancer, or you might be breast cancer or ovarian cancer. That's where genetics express disease within families. But when you stay within the laws of nature and you eat organically, you breathe clean air, you drink clean water, You don't have a lot of stress in your life. Your relationships are good. You're not going to express those diseases. But when those things are violated, that's when the genes can express themselves. And whatever your family might be prone to, that's when you come down with these diseases. But genetics in and of themselves are not the cause of disease. What did Gerson have to say about the cause of disease? In my opinion, cancer is not a problem of deficiencies in hormones, vitamins, and enzymes. It's not a problem of allergies, infections with a virus, or any other known or unknown organism. It is not a poisoning through some special intermediate metabolic substance coming from an outside so-called carcinogenic substance. It is all these that can be partial causative agents, contributing elements. Cancer is not a single cellular problem. It is an accumulation of numerous damaging factors combined in causing the deterioration of the whole metabolism and the liver, and when after the liver has been progressively impaired. So in other words, you've heard the phrase, everything in moderation? Well, we know that everything in moderation is killing us, because we're eating literally everything in moderation. And that's ultimately where disease is coming from. And that's why on our therapy, where our patients are getting 20 pounds of organic fruits and vegetables every day, we're reversing advanced terminal disease. And this is what we're going to get into right now. So combating cancer and degenerative diseases, there's three elements you have to address. That first element is toxicity. We've already mentioned everything that's being belched into our environment today. Our bodies are incredibly toxic. In each generation, what we're dealing with today compared to what Dr. Gerson was dealing with when he was alive, you can't even compare it. Each generation that's being born is constitutionally weaker than the generation before. We're seeing it. I started this 20 years ago. What's coming into our clinics now compared to what was coming in 20 years ago, it's like night and day. The people are younger, more and more children, more aggressive cancers, harder and harder to cure, just weaker and weaker constitutions. And for us to bring them back to health, it's getting more and more difficult. We need to get more and more creative. And so you've got to address the issue of toxicity. And we're going to go into how we do that. Probably the biggest factor today in disease is deficiency. We are so deficient. Our food today, it's devoid of nutrients. White sugar, white flour, white rice, pasta, ice cream, cakes, cookies, crackers. All of these things that we're eating today, they're extremely deficient. When you eat these processed foods, particularly things made with white sugar, white flour, white rice, those things used to have the vitamins and minerals that you needed to utilize them, to break them down, to digest them, to create energy. But when they've been stripped out, where is your body going to get the nutrients needed to utilize them? Well, your body has a reserve system. And that reserve system is actually designed to keep your body healthy. It's what your immune system uses to keep the body healthy. Where is that reserve system? It's in your bone. It's in your bone marrow. Your bone marrow is a nutrient powerhouse. And what happens is, think about every time in your life where you've had all those things I mentioned, the cookies, the cake, the ice cream, the pizza, the meat, the dairy, the fats, the oils. Oils are incredibly robbing of nutrition in your body. They rob the body of nutrition. So think about all the times you touched something and ate something like that. I mean, it's countless times. So every time you've eaten those, your body's had to rob your bone and your bone marrow in order to utilize those nutrients properly. And what happens over time? The immune system gets weaker and weaker because it's losing that reserve tank. And so people coming to us, they're so deficient. And everybody in this room is severely, severely deficient. We are not eating the amount of nutrients on a daily basis that we need to. If I take an x-ray, as a chiropractor, if I take an x-ray of somebody who's 55, 60 years old today, do you know what I see? I see severe osteoporosis, severe bone loss. because that nutrient reserve has been wrong daily for 40,
50, 60 years.
Can you hear me? I apologize for this, folks. So, anyway, so the reserve system is being robbed daily. So we've got to readdress that nutrient debt that we've created through years of abuse of our food. The final thing is you've got to address the issue of ATP production. What's ATP? Inside your cells, you have little organelles called mitochondria. Those mitochondria produce energy. And it's that energy that your body needs to rally an immune response. It's that energy that the body needs to rally an immune response. If you see somebody who's sick and dying, what's one of the first things you notice? They're lethargic. And they're lethargic because they've lost the capacity to produce energy on a cellular level. So you've got to be able to address that. And today, cancer researchers, they're all focusing in on the mitochondria. They know that's where the secret of disease, lies, is in the mitochondria. But how are they going to try to manipulate it? With drugs. But how do you create energy on a cellular level? There's only one way. Really only one way. Sugar. And you've heard that sugar feeds cancer. We're going to debunk that theory by the time you leave here. Sugar has nothing to do
with feeding
cancer. On the contrary, that's how you heal cancer. If sugar fed cancer, the Gerson therapy wouldn't cure one case of cancer. Because our patients are getting 4,000 calories daily in the form of simple sugars from fruits and vegetables. That's how the body produces sugar. Sugar enters the cell. If oxygen is present and the nutrients necessary to run the energy cycles, then you create energy. Sugar, nutrients, and oxygen. And it's the issue of oxygen where sugar can possibly feed cancer, and we're going to go into that. So these are the three issues you need to address: toxicity, deficiency, and energy production. Hold on one second.
Yes. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. So
this is much better.
That was really annoying. Okay. Anyway, so we've got to address toxicity, deficiency, and production of energy. How do we do that? Principles of the Gerson therapy. First and foremost, absolutely no sodium. No sodium whatsoever. Why? When you eat a lot of sodium, what happens? You need to drink a lot of water, right? So when you eat sodium, sodium and water enter the cells, and the cells swell up with water and sodium. And all your little organelles in there, they can't function properly. They can't function. It's called cellular edema. So rule number one on the Gerson therapy, not one drop of sodium. People say, well, I eat the good sodium. Well, no you don't, because there is no such thing. There's no such thing as good sodium, folks. All right? Table salt is 99% sodium chloride. That's a destructive molecule for the body. First of all, it does two things. Sodium chloride does two things. One, it swells up the cells with sodium and water. And two, the chloride molecule, it displaces iodine from the thyroid gland. You know what your thyroid gland does? It's responsible for replicating mitochondria. It produces mitochondria. So when you eat sodium chloride, which is table salt, right? But did you know that your Celtic salt, your Himalayan salt, do you know that that's 86% sodium chloride? There's a reason why the Dead Sea is dead. And that's because the sodium content can't support life. Now, if you're going to use salt, that's what you need to use. But even the expert, he wrote a book like, I don't know, 20 years ago, on all these natural salts. And in his book, his prescription, he said, okay, you take a quarter teaspoon of this natural salt, Celtic salt, Himalayan salt, and you put it into 32 ounces of water. And you dilute it in that 32 ounces and you sip that throughout the day. He said, any more than that on a daily basis, over time, and you can run into health problems. That's fine. A quarter of a teaspoon diluted in 32 ounces of water for a healthy person. For a cancer patient, no way. You can't. You destroy the production of energy on a cellular level if you're giving them sodium. All right? And when you eat meat or acidic things, meat, dairy, cheese, lots of fats, lots of oils, all the processed foods that cause acidity, do you know what happens then? You can't heal on that either. Certainly, you cannot heal eating meat. Why? Because preferentially, the body wants to dump sodium because it knows it's harmful for the body, ultimately. So preferentially, the kidneys are constantly trying to dump sodium. 230 milligrams a day. That's the standard obligatory loss of sodium in your body. So that's the amount you need on a daily basis. That's about a quarter of a teaspoon. Just like that man said. But when you eat meat, the amount of acidity that you generate, or when you drink Coke and all the other garbage, but particularly meat, the amount of acidity that you generate, now the kidneys have to preferentially drop the acidity in order to keep the body alive. And you know what it does in exchange for that? It uptakes sodium. So if you eat meat, you cannot heal if you're an advanced cancer patient. Because now, instead of dumping the sodium, which we want to do, and getting rid of it, now the body's uptaking the sodium to get rid of the acidity generated by the food you're eating. Okay? So absolutely no sodium on the Gerson therapy. That includes the good salt, which there is no such thing. All right? Okay. Our patients are getting 20 pounds of organic fruits and vegetables every single day. And if it's not organic, 99% of the time our patients don't survive. Why? A lot of reasons. We know the obvious ones. They spray it with pesticides, right? They spray it with pesticides, herbicides, fungicides, and we're trying to detoxify a body, not toxify it. So that's the obvious reason. The not so obvious reasons are, today, scientists have figured out that we can grow big, beautiful fruits and vegetables with three chemicals: nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. So the standard artificial fertilizer is called NPK. All right, that's the standard fertilizer that the conventional producers use. The problem is the human body needs 59 other vitamins and minerals to maintain a healthy immune system and certainly to cure a sick and dying one. And conventional produce doesn't have it. It has NPK. That's it. So conventional produce looks great. It's deadly. But the one thing you probably don't know is that before conventional produce goes to market, you know what they do with it? They irradiate it. They run it through radiation. Do you know why? Because if you can irradiate something, you cut off the enzyme activity. If you can cut off the enzyme activity, guess what you can do with it? You can store it on the shelves for longer. Well, here's the problem. All those enzymes in the food, particularly in the juices that we're giving, they destroy cancer. They break down diseased tissue. They rebuild new tissue with the nutrients that you're getting in the organic food. Conventional produce can't do it. So you've got to eat organic. Well, but organic's more expensive. Yes, it is. So that's your insurance policy. Stop buying insurance and eat organic food. That's your insurance. I don't have insurance. Now in the United States, I'm obligated to pay for insurance by the U.S., by Obamacare. I still don't do it. I have no insurance. So I get penalized every month or every year in my taxes because I don't have insurance. I don't need it. Detoxification. Folks, there's two ways to detoxify the human body efficient. First one is the coffee enema. There is nothing better to detoxify the human body than a coffee enema. Let me explain. Your liver produces an enzyme called glutathione transferase. The chemical base that the body uses to make glutathione transferase is palmitic acid. The body uses palmitic acid to create glutathione. Coffee, properly roasted, organic coffee, without cream sugar, okay? Properly roasted organic coffee is loaded with palmitic acid. And studies have shown that when you do one coffee enema, just one, the production of glutathione transferase by the body goes up 600 to 700% greater than normal. 600 to 700% greater than normal. Our patients are getting 5 a day. I do one a day, not three. Sometimes I do three. When I'm at the clinic and I'm doing 13 juices, when I'm at the clinic, I pound out the therapy. I do 13 juices a day, 2 to 3 coffee enemas a day. I'm eating all my organic food. I'm not eating meat. I'm not eating garbage. When I leave the clinic, all hell breaks loose. When I travel, it's hard. It's hard to eat organic. Like when I got here yesterday, first thing I did, ran down to the gas station, got 3 bottles of Evian water, bought all the produce that I could find. I got raspberries, cherries, blueberries, all non-organic, of course. But I will say, they taste a lot better here, and it's probably because the EU has stricter regulations on GMO foods, pesticides, and things like that. So I find that when I come to a place like Europe, the quality of the produce seems to be a little better than the United States. So anyway, so that's what I do. But it's hard to maintain that, you know? I can't constantly be running down to convenience stores, you know, and buying these things. So I end up being a slave to what typically most of us are eating. But when I'm back at the clinic, that's what we're doing. Our patients are getting 5 coffee enemas per day. Sometimes if they're really toxic, if they have really large tumor loads, they're in extreme pain, which coffee enemas are amazing for pain. Felicity can testify to that. She had extreme issues with pain when she was sick, and things that made them better were the coffee enemas. All right? So, the coffee enema, the most potent way to detoxify the body. Not only that, it's a natural form of dialysis. It's a natural form of dialysis. You and I, as we sit here right now for 15 minutes, your blood circulating through your liver and your kidneys 2.5 times in 15 minutes for your entire body. When you do a coffee enema, it circulates 5 times through your liver and your kidneys. That's effective dialysis. All right? Not only that, it stimulates bile production. Why is that important? So it does the same thing when you drink coffee, the bile production, all right? Not the palmitic acid glutathione transferase production as much, because the coffee you're drinking, the roast, when it goes through the digestive tract, the palmitic acid salts get burned up in the digestive system, so it's not the same in terms of glutathione production when you're drinking it. But when you take it rectally, it stimulates bile flow. Why is that important? Because how does your body detoxify? Your body binds toxins to bile acids. Those bile acids get dumped in the gallbladder and they get released from the intestinal tract and the kidneys. So when you drink coffee and when you do the coffee enema, the amount of bile that's being stimulated is exponentially greater than normal. All right? So the coffee enema is probably the most ingenious thing that Dr. Gerson came up with to cure people of their diseases. And he can't cure them without the coffee enemas. We can't cure advanced terminal cancer without the coffee enemas. In fact, when Gerson started treating cancer, in the beginning, he started losing a lot of his first patients. He lost several of them because with all the juicing and all the food, he was breaking down tumors so quickly that they were going into chemotoxic shock, and he lost a few. So he had to come up with a way to detoxify the body, and that was with the coffee enemas. The second thing we do is castor oil. Castor oil. And you know what? The funny thing is, your grandparents and their parents, when they were sick, what did they get? They got castor oil. What else did they get? They got enemas. They got enemas. That was standard practice in families 50, 60, 70, 80 years ago. Until the medical doctor said, oh, that's all voodoo folk medicine. It's useless. It's all a lie. They totally reprogrammed our minds through the media, through the boob tube, or the idiot box, as we call it in the United States, you know? So they programmed our minds again. So we're using castor oil. Why? Castor oil, believe it or not, it's a poison to the body. The body cannot break it down, but it does everything it can to break it down. How do you break down such a thick fat like that? Bile. Bile produced by the liver and the gall and dumped into the gallbladder and dumped into the intestinal tract. Bile is an emulsifier of fats. It breaks down fat. So when you take castor oil orally, your body can't break it down, but it does everything it can. And it just starts dumping massive amounts of bile into the intestinal tract, trying to break it down. And what's attached to that bile? Toxins. Stored toxins. So coffee enema, castor oil, ingenious, there is no more powerful way to detoxify the human body. We'll take questions at the end, okay? All right, supplementation. And this is what made Gerson a genius as well. Supplementation, potassium. Gerson came up with a special potassium compound powder that he created after 300 different experiments. And why is this potassium powder so powerful? Simple. You have an inverse relationship in the body between sodium and potassium. An inverse relationship. You take sodium, your body dumps potassium. You take potassium, and your body dumps sodium. Okay? Why is this important? Well, what did we say first thing? No sodium on the Gerson diet. Why? Because everything's doing in the human body. Okay? Patients that come to my clinic, in the first week, they lose 7 to 10 pounds in water weight alone. 7 to 10 pounds in water weight alone. We're storing up that much sodium and water in our bodies from our diet today. The buffet here, I ate at the buffet here today. You know how salty that thing was? So right now, I need potassium. Okay? So the potassium, what it does is it dumps all the sodium. And then the cells can start to restructure themselves again. And here's the other thing potassium does. We're taught in school, okay, medical doctors, chiropractors, we're taught outdated cellular biology. We're taught that our cells are just this free-floating ocean of all these little organelles swimming around carrying out their activities. But that's been disproven by a guy from the University of Washington, Gerald Pollack. He wrote a book called Cells, Gels, and the Engines of Life. And he was able to prove that our cells are actually structured like water, like ice is structured. Like the scaffolding in this building upholds the integrity of this building, our cells are structured the same exact way. And that structure is completely dependent on the potassium content within the cell. And if you lose that potassium content, the entire structure collapses. And so everything that functions inside of there, nutrients, detoxification, all the enzyme activity, energy production, it breaks down. And what are we doing today? We're actually destroying our bodies because we're not getting the amount of potassium we need, which you get from what? Fruits and vegetables. That's where you get potassium. Our diets are reversed. What's the Bible tell us today? Or what does it tell us? We come from the ground, right? Okay, if you analyze true organic soil, the potassium to sodium ratios are extraordinary. 1,000 molecules of potassium to like 10 molecules of sodium, or even less. We're potassium animals. And the reason why we're getting sick today is we got it all reversed. We're eating loads of sodium, and we're not getting enough potassium. So we bombard the body with potassium, not just in the juices, but our patients get 4 teaspoons of Dr. Gerson's potassium powder diluted in every single juice. And that's how we're reversing advanced disease. That sodium gets out, potassium gets in, the cell gets restructured, and all the energy production capacity, the nutrient capacity, the detoxification capacity of the body starts to take over again. CoQ10, coenzyme Q10. All right, so how do you create energy? Sugar, in the presence of oxygen, and all the nutrients you need to run the energy cycle. So when a molecule of sugar enters the cell, it goes through something called the Krebs cycle. So a molecule of sugar enters the cell, and if oxygen is present, it goes through the Krebs cycle. Well, in the Krebs cycle, 3 reactions take place, and you get 3 molecules of something called nicotinic acid dehydrogenase. So one sugar molecule produces 3 molecules of nicotinic acid dehydrogenase. Those 3 molecules of nicotinic acid dehydrogenase get shuttled down a special system called the electron transport chain. And that electron transport chain is completely dependent on CoQ10. So when we give CoQ10, we give it in massive amounts, 300 milligrams a day. 50 milligrams, 6 times a day. They're getting it all day long. So they're getting all these sugars from the juices, and in the presence of oxygen, are going through the energy cycles. And this is what helps to stimulate that energy production. Now, you've all heard about alkalinity and acidity, right? Right? Alkaline good, acidity bad. But that's really never explained to us. What does that mean? Well, when we're talking about alkalinity and acidity, what are we talking about? pH. What's pH? Potential hydrogen. pH is potential hydrogen. So if you're acidic, what does that mean? That means that you have a buildup of hydrogen in the body. And guess what happens when you have a buildup of hydrogen in the body? The true definition of acidity is improper oxygen utilization. When you're acidic, you can't properly utilize oxygen. Why? Because hydrogen, it has a charge. So does oxygen. Well, around your cells, you have something called a cell membrane. Does anybody know what that cell membrane is made up of? It's made up of fats. What kind of fats? Whatever fats you're eating, your body's going to use it to maintain that cell membrane. You know what that cell membrane does? That's your gatekeeper. That cell membrane determines everything that can go into the cell and what has to go out of the cell. It enters everything that needs to go in, and it keeps everything from getting in that needs to stay out, and vice versa. So that cell membrane is made up of fats, whatever fats you're eating. You've heard of saturated fats, right? Saturated fats. Does anybody know what fats are saturated with? Hydrogen. Have you ever read a label, partially hydrogenated oil? What does that mean? That means these companies have taken oils and they bubbled hydrogen into the oil. Does anybody know why? Because when you bubble hydrogen into something, you stabilize it. And if you can stabilize, you can keep it on shelves for longer. So, what are we eating today, folks? You've heard of essential fatty acids, right? Essential fatty acids are good for you. Why? Because they have special double bond structures that aren't bounded by hydrogen. What are we eating today? Meat, cheese, ice cream, cakes, cookies, all these things loaded with saturated fats. So all our cells today, their cell membranes are loaded with saturated fats. You know what happens when the body's loaded with saturated hydrogen? The charge at the level of the cell membrane, as oxygen approaches the cell membrane, the charge literally bounces it away. You can't properly oxygenate tissues if you're loaded with hydrogen. And so if you want to be loaded with hydrogen, go ahead and keep drinking milk, keep eating cheese, keep eating meat, because it's all saturated fats. That's the problem today. So the definition of acidity is improper oxygen utilization. Guess what's guess what happens if sugar enters enters the cell without oxygen being present because of acidity? It goes into something called anaerobic glycolysis. Instead of going through the Krebs cycle, it goes into anaerobic glycolysis. You know what the final production of anaerobic glycolysis is? Lactic acid, and lactic acid feeds cancer. So when people say sugar feeds cancer, there's about 10% of truth to that. Sugar feeds cancer in an acidic environment. Sugar heals cancer in an alkaline environment. So how do you take this acidic environment and create an alkaline environment? There's only one way, folks. It's juicing. It's raw fruits and vegetables. It's the only way. Why? When you drink a juice, you know if I test a juice, like a lemon juice or a carrot juice, you know if I test it with litmus paper, it'll actually test acidic. But when I drink it and it goes into my body, it gets broken down into potassium hydroxide. Potassium hydroxide. A hydroxyl molecule written chemically is OH negative. OH negative. A hydrogen molecule is written H positive. We got to neutralize that H positive or we die. The OH negative molecule in the potassium hydroxide reacts with the hydrogen. What do you think is created when OH negative reacts with H positive? Two H's and an O. Water. All of a sudden you neutralize all that acidity. And the charge now at the level of the cell membrane and inside the cells can now accept oxygen into the cells. And now your sugars from fruits and vegetables can be converted to energy. And the immune system rallies and you cure disease. That is the biggest secret that you can leave here today on how to cure advanced disease. Neutralizing hydrogen through the use of juicing. There is no other way. So that's how we're doing it. CoQ10, I already explained why. Niacin. Anybody ever taken niacin? What happens when you take it? You flush, right? You get hot, red, itchy. Okay. Why are we doing that? We're doing that for two reasons. One, remember that nicotinic acid dehydrogenase, three molecules for one molecule of sugar? What's NADH? Or what's niacin? Niacin is nicotinic acid. So it increases the energy pool. All right? It increases the nicotinic acid dehydrogenase pool when you take it. That's why you get hot, red, and flushy, and you just get this burst of energy. Okay? But the main reason why we do it is because an advanced cancer patient, you know what they need above all things, except the nutrients? Rest. You exercise as an advanced cancer patient, your chances of survival go down dramatically. We see it all the time. If you're healthy, exercise is great for you. It keeps you healthy through the proper oxygenation of tissue. But if you're sick, exercise will kill you when you have advanced terminal cancer. Why? What are we trying to do? We're creating energy on a cellular level. Why? So we can rally an immune response. If you take that energy we're creating on a cellular level, and you go out and exercise, play your tennis, go jog your 5 kilometers, whatever, you're going to use up all that energy we're trying to heal with. Your world-class athletes, they have the worst immune systems on the planet. When their triathlon's over, when their football season's over, when their boxing match is over, the one they spent months preparing for, their bodies crash for 2-3 months. They are exhausted, they get sick. Why? Because they use all that energy for peak performance and not for the immune system to maintain itself. Right? So when our patients exercise, we can't heal them. So what do? We give them niacin. Exercise, it increases the exchange of the bloodstream to the tissue. Okay? When you exercise, what happens? You sweat. You open up the capillary system. You get the exchange of blood to the tissue. We need that. We need to get all these nutrients, all these supplements we're giving, we need to get it to every corner of the body because that's where cancer cells are. But they can't exercise. So we give them niacin. Niacin, they get niacin all day long. They get like 8 or 9 50 milligram tabs all day long. And what that does is that keeps the capillaries in constant expansion so that the exchange between the bloodstream and the tissue is at its peak at all times without exercise. That's how you heal disease. We've got to get these nutrients to every corner of the body. We could send people out and have them jog for a few miles. That'll get it going. We can't do that. So we give niacin. It's ingenious. Pancreatic enzymes. Okay. 75% of your immune system is in your digestive tract. So if you're sick, your digestive tract is sick. That's a fact. Okay? If you have cancer, if you have any disease, your digestive tract is sick. So we need to give it enzymes to help it function, to break food down into energy. That's the definition of metabolism. Break food down into energy. Well, people who come to us, they can't break down their food properly. That's obvious, because their digestive tracts are shot. So we give pancreatic enzymes. But the most important thing about pancreatic enzymes is they are potent destroyers of tumors and cancer cells. Ladies, when you're pregnant, do you know in your 7th week of pregnancy, you get a massive burst of pancreatic enzymes? Do you know that? Do you know why? Because they say cancer cells are very similar to embryonic cells. Why? Because they're dividing rapidly. So as that egg is dividing into the, or is embedding itself in the uterine wall, it's dividing very rapidly. And if you don't get that burst of pancreatic enzymes at that 7th week, that egg can continue dividing and cells can penetrate the uterine wall and enter the general systemic circulation, dividing that rapidly. And by the end of a pregnancy, you could be ravaged with cancer. Because if those embryonic cells penetrate the uterine wall and continue to divide rapidly, by the end of your pregnancy, you'll be loaded with cancer. And we're seeing that more and more and more. When Dr. Gerson was alive, he'd usually see, you know, women who were 40, 50, 67 years old who've had 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 children. That's when they would come in. Today we're seeing them after having one. Why? Pancreatic enzymes, at that 7th week, that's the protective mechanism to stop that division of that embryo as it embeds itself in the uterine wall. Today, from the day we're born till the day a woman gets pregnant, every single day, we're doing everything humanly possible to destroy the pancreas. How do you destroy the pancreas? Sugars, milk, dairy, cheese, meat, pasta, ice cream, cookies, cakes, soy. Soy destroys the pancreas. Destroys it. Everything we've done from the day we're born to the day a woman gets pregnant destroys the pancreas. So when she gets pregnant today, at the seventh week, she has no pancreatic sufficiency to give her that burst of pancreatic enzymes. And that's why at the end of her pregnancy or a year or two afterwards, she's ravaged with cancer. We're destroying ourselves using a highly, highly concentrated pancreatic enzyme high in alpha-chymotrypsin. Alpha-chymotrypsin is the enzyme component that breaks down tumors in cancer cells, all right? B12 injections. We need B12, okay? A healthy digestive tract can produce its own B12. But we're rebuilding a digestive tract. So until we can rebuild a healthy digestive tract, we need to give B12 injections. Because where do you get B12 from typically? From meat, from animal products, okay? So this is actually like a crude liver injection that contains high amounts of B12. We also supplement with a little B12 now because the bodies now are so broken down, so constitutionally weak, that we now feel like we need to add more B12 because it's responsible for cellular regeneration. All right. Stomach enzymes. We get stomach enzymes simply for helping the body to break food down into energy. So we give hydrochloric acid, betaine HCl, and pepsin. All right. Crude liver extract, we inject that. Very high in vitamin B, all right? Very high in B vitamins, crude liver extract with the B12, we inject that. All right, here's one of the most important components of the Gerson therapy supplement protocol, flax oil. Gerson tried every oil he had available to him in his time, and the only one he found that didn't cause tumors to get worse was flax oil. Why? Flax oil, again, has a very special double bond structure not saturated with hydrogen. And that structure literally attracts oxygen into the cells, because of its charge. So that special double bond structure. You know, in a healthy body, a little bit of coconut oil, maybe a little bit of olive oil, it's healthy, but it's saturated. Those are saturated fats. Olive oil is a monounsaturated fat, so one bond is saturated with hydrogen, the other bond is not. Coconut oil, pure saturated fat. That's why I can put coconut oil in a relatively cool room and it's hard. It's stable, right? I can put flax oil in a freezer and I can keep it there for 10 days and when it comes out, it'll be frozen for 1 minute. 1 minute later, it's completely liquid, because of that special double bond structure. So when we get 2 tablespoons of flax oil every day, all right, that goes towards maintaining those cell membranes with the proper fats, essential fatty acids, flax oil. We give a natural thyroid glandulin. I already told you why. The thyroid is specifically responsible for replicating mitochondrial DNA. It reproduces mitochondria. So it makes our work that much more efficient when we give a thyroid. So let's say right now in your cells, you have 1,000 mitochondria in a cell. Well, when we're giving 20 pounds of organic fruits and vegetables and all these natural sugars, we need to convert it to energy as efficiently as possible. So if I give you natural thyroid glandulin instead of having 1,000 in your cells, now you got 2,000. Because we're stimulating the mitochondrial production by the thyroid gland. All right? So we give natural thyroid glandulin. We talked about how chloride displaces iodine from the thyroid gland. You know what else displaces iodine from the thyroid gland? Fluoride. Fluoride displaces iodine from the thyroid gland. And then one more thing, bromine. Does anybody know where you're getting bromine every single day in your life? Bread. You know, they used to condition breads with iodine. Australia has now passed a law requiring all bread makers to condition their breads with iodine. Why? Because Australia has a socialist healthcare system, right? So they're the ones footing the bill for all the health problems coming into their clinics as a result of brominated bread. They used to condition bread with iodine. And then somebody came up with the bright idea, it was probably cheaper, to do it with bromine. So today, bromine is in all your breads. That's why if you go to a health food store, you'll see breads, and they're labeled made with unbrominated flour. Okay? You'll see breads labeled that way in health food stores. Okay, so chlorine, fluoride, bromine, all destroying the thyroid gland today. A swimmer like a Michael Phelps or somebody like that, by the time they're 40, 45, 50 years old, you can just go ahead and ask them how many milligrams of Synthroid you've taken. Because they're swimming in chlorinated pools. People who swim competitively, they destroy their thyroid glands. Lugol solution. We give thyroid and Lugol solution together. Lugol solution is potassium iodine. Okay? Iodine is toxic to the body. It can't give a lot of iodine, which is the organic form of iodine. Then there's potassium iodide, which is inorganic. Now, we're not talking organic conventional produce. We're talking about chemistry here. So the inorganic form of, and more non-toxic form of iodine is Lugol solution. So our patients are getting massive amounts of iodine, and they're gradually being weaned off it, along with the thyroid. As we stimulate the metabolism, we get to lower these supplements. And folks, don't think for one second that all these things are, you know, safe. They're not safe. If you do too much for too long, they can become detrimental. So they're good to initially stimulate metabolism, to stimulate energy production. But as we go on in time, we have to wean our patients off of these things. Yeah, they're all natural, no doubt. But even natural things can be dangerous. Like if you do coffee enemas without doing the juicing, you're going to destroy your body. And the reason why is because when you stimulate that glutathione transferase system, that requires nutrients. To make glutathione transferase, you need all your B vitamins, vitamin C, vitamin K. You need all of those things to stimulate that system. But if you're already depleted because you're sick, you're going to deplete your body even more if you're doing coffee enemas without doing the juicing. You can't do it. Every time I lecture, everybody wants to do the coffee enema, and where do I get the potassium compound powder? But they don't want to change their lifestyle. Can't. It's dangerous. Okay, we've now added pure, unadulterated, fresh, cold-pressed aloe vera straight from the Dominican Republic. So it's harvested organically in the Dominican Republic, and it's sent to us over 2 to 3 days frozen. When it arrives to us in California, it's completely frozen. And then we add 1 to 2 ounces of that per juice. And you want to talk about a healing, potent substance for the digestive tract? Pure aloe vera. Now, the aloe vera you get in the health food stores, it's been preserved. It's got preservatives in it. It's not fresh. This is as fresh as you can possibly get it. Okay? And so we've added aloe vera. Very, very potent healing. Okay. Adjunctive therapies that we're using. Vitamin C. IV vitamin C. Our patients are getting 50,000 milligrams of IV vitamin C 3 to 4 times per week, along with chelation therapy. Alright? We have a huge heavy metal issue today in this world. Alright? Mercury from our fillings, mercury from vaccines, cadmium coming out of car exhaust, which depletes the body of zinc, and you know, there's just so many heavy metals in our environment today. So we have to chelate those heavy metals, because heavy metals destroy enzyme activity. For example, mercury destroys selenium-based enzymes, which are almost 90% of the enzyme systems in your body require selenium. And mercury destroys the selenium-based enzymes. So we need to supplement with a lot of selenium today for that reason. We do dendritic cell therapy. Dendritic cells are like generals in your body. They go out throughout the system seeking out threats to the system, and then they present that threat to the immune system, the army. And then it's the army that rallies the response. So we take your dendritic cells, and over a 3 to 4 day period, your dendritic cells are multiplied exponentially. And then they're reintroduced into your body. And that rallies an immune response. Your body becomes extra sensitive to what's going on inside. And so those extra dendritic cells are there to alert the immune system, and the immune system rallies an immune response. And if you look at the bottom there, you'll see cholecystins. When we do dendritics with cholecystins, the effects are exponentially greater for each one. Why? What are cholecystins? William B. Coley was a Harvard medical doctor before Gerson was born. He discovered that when his patients came down with staph or strep infections, their tumors got better or disappeared completely. But when their condition got better, the tumors came back. When their infections went away, the tumors would come back. So he began to culture the bacterial toxins that staph and strep bacteria make. And he would inject those toxins into the connective tissue of his cancer patients, particularly sarcoma patients. And his results proved that you could get permanent cures in a lot of cases. He was able to achieve permanent cures in many cases by injecting these bacterial toxins. Well, Gerson, in the book he wrote before he died, he theorized that if he could give Coley's toxins while giving the Gerson therapy, his results would be exponentially greater. But he never got the chance to do them because he died. Well, we're doing them. And we're seeing those results. What Coley failed to recognize, that he was taking patients that were already depleted, that's why they were sick, and he was artificially stimulating their immune systems. He wasn't replacing it with the vital nutrition they needed. So he wasn't able to achieve as great of a cure rate or success as Dr. Gerson's therapy was. Had he done that, his therapies, his cholecystins would have been exponentially more effective. But we're doing that. And we're reintroducing that nutrition that the body needs. Gerson was right. Laetrile. Felicity did laetrile. We give 6 to 9 grams of laetrile. 6 to 9 grams IV every single day of the week except Saturdays and Sundays. 5 days a week, 6 to 9 grams. And 6 to 9 grams of laetrile is roughly 1,800 apricot kernels. So people are out there eating apricot kernels. Here's a problem. That's a big problem. Because patients on the Gerson therapy, one of the forbidden foods, nuts and seeds. Can't eat nuts and seeds on the Gerson therapy. Too high in fat, and they're too hard to digest. You want to destroy a patient's ability to get better, just feed them nuts and seeds. They won't survive if they're eating a lot of nuts and seeds. So people are out there eating a lot of apricot kernels, and it's just too hard on their digestive tract, and they're not getting the therapeutic amount of laetrile that they need. 6 to 9 grams is the therapeutic amount. And when you do it with hyperthermia, you increase its effects tenfold. So when you submerge their body in hyperthermia, like temperatures of 108 or greater in water, like a jacuzzi, that makes laetrile exponentially more effective. All right. So we're doing laetrile with hyperthermia. We know that cancer, viruses, bacteria, they can't survive in an environment above 107 degrees. That's why when you get sick, what does your body do? It spikes a fever. Some require 102, 100, 304, but cancer requires 106, 107. So our patients stay in hyperthermia conditions for about 40 minutes at about 110 to 112 degrees in a hot tub. And it's a hot tub that goes back to 2002. Because now they make hot tubs, they're regulated. Since like 2004, you can't get a hot tub to go above 104 degrees. They've been regulated. So we bought one from 2002, and they go up to like 112 degrees. Let me tell you something. You been in a 112 degrees hot tub? So anyway, hyperthermia and laetrile, all right? 1931, a guy by the name of Otto Warburg won the Nobel Prize in Medicine. He won it in medicine, 1931, for proving that cancer, viruses, and bacteria can't survive in highly oxygenated environments. Can't do it. They can't survive in highly oxygenated environments. So we give massive amounts of oxygen therapy on our protocol. We give hyperbaric oxygen. We give ozone. We give hydrogen peroxide. We stick hydrogen peroxide in your jacuzzi. We give ozone rectally. Okay. We give hyperbaric oxygen. And now we got this fancy thing called Beamer mat. That looks like a glorified yoga mat, but it costs $7,000. You lie on this Beamer mat, I kid you not. What this thing is doing today, if I took a pinprick of your blood right now and put it on a microscope, every single person in this room, your blood is clumped together. Think about that. So if your blood's clumped together, how's your ability to use oxygen going to be? How's your ability to absorb nutrients and get rid of toxins going to be? So due to our diet, stress, lifestyle, your blood's all clumped together. You lie down on this Beamer mat, these blood cells, they dissipate, like they just release. And then you take a pinprick and you put it on a microscope and they're all just floating around. Complete round red blood cells. They say that this Beamer mat is oxygenating tissues 35% greater than hyperbaric oxygen. So now our protocol is we lie people on this Beamer mat for 8 to 16 minutes twice a day, and then immediately after we stick them in the hyperbaric oxygen chamber, which is pounding in 4,000 pounds per square inch of oxygen into the bloodstream. That's effective medicine. It was proven in 1931. You know, today in the United States, if you have cancer and you go to any hyperbaric oxygen clinic and you say, I've got cancer, I'd like to take 10 sessions of your hyperbaric oxygen. You know what? You know what happens? You get turned away. They won't do it. They can't do it legally. It's illegal in the United States to use hyperbaric oxygen to treat disease. You can only use it for wounds, burns, and diabetic gangrene. Oh, and what do you call it when you get the bends from scuba diving? You can use it for that too. You cannot use it to heal disease. Why? Because that's how you heal disease. They won't allow it. Keep them sick and make them sicker. That's what they're doing. All right? So, a lot of oxygen therapy. Artist said the aloe vera, we use powder arco, Essiac tea, and milk thistle tea. Three potent anti-cancer teas. Milk thistle specific for breast cancer. You got breast cancer, drink copious amounts of milk thistle tea. Drink copious amounts of Essiac tea. Essiac tea came from the native Indians. It was actually discovered by Renee Cassé from Canada. But she discovered it from the native Indians of Canada and the United States. They used Essiac tea, which is a formulation of four or five different teas, like I think burdock, comfrey, sheep chorale, something like that. I don't know. I don't know the combinations exactly. But it's called Essiac tea. Alright? And so we use that with milk thistle tea to rebuild the liver and highly specific for breast cancer. Breast cancer patients, sweet wormwood tea, soursop tea. So soursop, Essiac, milk thistle, and sweet wormwood. Why sweet wormwood? Because it's high in iodine. Clear link between breast cancer and iodine deficiency. Clear link between breast cancer and dairy. The casein molecule in dairy, breast cancer. So if you're a breast cancer patient, you may not have any dairy. Zero. Okay? All right. Curcumin. The study's coming out now on curcumin are crystal clear. What's curcumin? Turmeric. Right? You know, I know it as turmeric. All right? So we give turmeric now to our patients. All right? This is what we call the advanced Gerson therapy, folks. If Gerson was the consummate scientist, he was constantly perfecting his therapy based on what was coming out in the scientific literature of his time. If he was alive today, his therapy would look much different than it was back then, or much more advanced. And I guarantee you, he'd be using a lot of this stuff. And that's what separates us from other Gerson clinics, particularly the Gerson Institute. All right? I no longer work with the Gerson Institute. I had to leave them. Because they, to this day, they've refused to progress Dr. Gerson's therapy, as he himself mentioned in his book. They've refused. Why? I have no idea. It was time to move it forward, and that's what we've done. Far infrared technology. You can Google the effects of far infrared technology. There's a great book called The Medicine of Light. Read it. The Medicine of Light. What they're finding out now is that when you bombard the body with chlorophyll, Okay, where do you get chlorophyll? Our green juices, spirulina, chlorella. When you bombard the body with chlorophyll, the cancer cells suck up the chlorophyll. And then when you hit it with far infrared light that penetrates 5 to 10 inches into the body, that light gets soaked up by the cancer cells and the cancer cells die. They say that this far infrared technology is killing cancer cells just as effectively as chemo, minus the side effects. You can Google it, it's out there, all right? So, I think I covered all that. Typical response to the Gerson therapy, tumors are typically destroyed within 6 to 9 months. Sometimes we see it quicker, sometimes we see it a little bit later, all right? If you go to our Facebook page, Northern Baja Gerson Center, Northern Baja Gerson Center, just put up an absolutely shocking video testimonial of a guy who came to our clinic in January with severely advanced prostate cancer that had spread to every bone in his body. On his CAT scan, it lit up like a Christmas tree, okay? Prostate cancer, severely advanced, comes in January. A week and a half ago, I get a voicemail on my phone. Hey, Dr. Patrick, this is Tom King. I was there in January. Just want you to know I'm cancer-free. When I got that voicemail, I said, no way. Because what he had on the basic Gerson therapy, and even with our advanced protocols, there was no way within 6-7 months he could be cancer-free. Even on what we do, it would take much longer for somebody like that. So I call him up. I said, Tom, you're telling me you're cancer-free? Yep, Dr. Patrick, I'm cancer-free. He's from New York, okay? I said, Tom, are you doing something else other than what we taught you at our clinic? Because we didn't have the Beamer mat then. We just introduced the Beamer mat a month ago. He said, yeah, I've been using this thing called the Beamer mat. And I just went ecstatic. I was so excited because without a doubt, that Beamer mat, with what we gave him, that is what got him cancer-free so quickly. All right? So, high blood pressure. 2 to 3 weeks, you're off all your high blood pressure meds. Heart disease. You scheduled for a triple quadruple bypass surgery, 3 to 4 weeks, we're canceling your surgery. Diabetes, Elbert Schweitzer, 6 to 8 weeks, gone. I put 8 to 12 here just to be generous. Okay, simple stuff, folks. Weight loss, 0.5 to 1 pound daily. Well, some people say, well, I don't need to lose weight. You won't. If you don't need to lose weight, you won't. If you give me somebody who's 50 pounds overweight, and you give me somebody who's 25 pounds underweight, eats like a pig and can't gain weight, if you put these people on the same exact therapy, this person will lose their 50 pounds, this person will gain their 25 pounds on the same exact therapy. Why? What have we been talking about this whole time? Regulation of metabolism. Increasing the body's ability to break food down into energy and to utilize nutrition properly. So you give me the obese person, you give me the skinny person that can't gain weight, and I'll get them both better. Because it's restoring metabolism, okay? So if you don't need to lose weight, you won't. You'll gain it if you need to, all right? So weight loss, 0.5 to 1 pound daily across the board. All the time I have companions coming up to me, people who come as the patient's companion, they just get 3 juices a day in their meals while they're at the clinic. They'll lose 10 to 15 pounds in their 3 weeks. It's crazy. Skin conditions, Albert Schweitzer's daughter, doesn't matter. Whatever skin condition you got, you're gonna get better. What's your skin? What are your 2 primary detoxifying organs in the body? The liver and the kidneys. If the liver and the kidneys are overloaded with all the toxicity from your life, what's gonna become your 3rd eliminative organ? The skin. Simple stuff. Asthma, simple. Primary cause of asthma today? Dairy. Dairy. You want to give a kid asthma? Eat him dairy. Drug and alcohol abuse. I wish more people would come to us for this, or maybe we'd establish a separate clinic. In 3 days on the Gerson therapy, you no longer have a desire for your drug of choice, whether it be alcohol, crack cocaine, you know, whatever. cigarettes, within 3 days, your desire for your drug is pretty much gone. And within 3 to 7 days, no withdrawal symptoms. No, that's what really causes people to fall off the wagon, the withdrawal symptoms. Okay, so why don't you have the cravings for the drug? What are you craving when you're craving the drug? You're craving energy. That drug gives them energy, right? The alcohol, the cocaine gives them that boost of energy. 13 juices a day, 20 pounds of organic fruits and vegetables a day, that'll give you your energy. You're not gonna crave drugs. Why no withdrawal symptoms? What are withdrawal symptoms? Withdrawal symptoms are the body dumping too many toxins at one time, and it just wreaks havoc on their neurotransmission, and they go nuts. Well, we get rid of that with 5 coffee enemas a day. There's no withdrawal symptoms, folks. And how many people are in and out, in and out, in and out of rehab? If they came to us for 2-3 months, cured. Superior athletic performance. But Dr. Patrick, on this therapy, where am I going to get my protein from? Well, where does a horse or a cow get their protein from? It's not from meat. Have you ever seen a cow or a horse? Have you ever touched a cow or a horse? Right? Or you see them out pumping iron and going, you know? No. They're eating grass all day. Loaded with protein. Okay? Your protein needs are met on this therapy. Okay? They're met. And especially later on in the therapy when you're adding lentils, quinoa, oatmeal. You read Ezekiel 4:9. You read the book of Ezekiel, chapter 4, verse 9. It tells you how to make your bread. If you make your bread that way, it becomes a complete protein. You don't need meat. What's in Ezekiel 4:9? Does anybody know? Huh? Lentils, spelt, wheat, millet. When you combine those 4 things together, the amino acid components of each make a complete protein. You don't need meat. Okay? It's one of the biggest fallacies out there. Where am I going to get my protein? Where am I going to get my calcium from? Right? I got to get it from milk, right? You know dairy causes osteoporosis? You know dairy causes bone loss? And they tell you it's good for your bone. Who tells you that? The milk and dairy industry. They spend billions upon billions of dollars on propaganda campaigns. If you go to the United States, you're driving down the highway, what do you see? You see a big banner, got milk, and somebody's got a milk mustache. It's such a lie. It causes osteoporosis. Okay, one more thing, and I think we're done. Here's a wonderful, incredible, prophetic quote. Dr. Benjamin Rush, one of the signatories of our Declaration of Independence in the United States, he says, unless we put medical freedom into the Constitution, the time will come when medicine will organize into an undercover dictatorship to restrict the art of healing to one class of men and deny equal privilege to others. It will be to constitute the Bastille, or the overthrow, right, the Bastille, the French Bastille, of medical science. All such laws are un-American and despotic and have no place in a republic. The constitution of this republic should make special privilege for medical freedom as well as religious freedom. An undercover dictatorship. How do you know it's an undercover dictatorship? Here's how. If my 16-year-old boy comes down with cancer and I want to do the Gerson therapy on him, I say to the oncologist, I say, you know what? I don't want that toxic poison you're going to give my kid. I don't want you to radiate him. And you don't need to do surgery on him either. I want to do the Gerson therapy. You know what happens? In 15 minutes, I kid you not, 15 minutes, somebody from social services in the United States comes into the oncologist's office, takes my son away from me, and I go to jail. Those are the laws in the United States. By law, anybody under the age of 18 is forced to do chemotherapy because they are a product of the state until they're 18 years old. And the state decides what they'll do. And so because the state are politicians, who do you think their campaigns are funded by? The pharmaceutical and medical industry. So they've gotten the politicians to pass laws to make my work illegal in the United States, which is why I'm in Mexico. I'm in Mexico because if I open this clinic and I treat people with cancer and disease, I go to jail. And if I treat my son or any child, I can't take children. The only way I can take a child is if I get a written signed affidavit by the oncologist stating that they have been released from their care and they can do nothing for them anymore. That's the only time I can take a child. Because if I take a child apart from that, the feds will literally come into Mexico, take the child, I go to jail, my clinic gets shut down, and I'm finished. The land of the free. Alright? So that's it, folks. This is how you cure advanced disease. There is nothing... There is nothing more powerful than the Gerson therapy to cure advanced disease. It's not out there. To this day, 50 years after Gerson's death, he remains the greatest genius in medical history. And we've taken his work and we've taken it to a new level, and it's just getting more and more exciting. So join our Facebook page. We're always posting testimonials, recipes we use at the Gerson Clinic, because, again, there's a lot of forbidden foods on the Gerson therapy, all right? Do I have 2 minutes here? 2 minutes. Yeah. Forbidden foods. Avocados. If you're a dying cancer patient, you can't have avocados. For somebody who's healthy, they're a perfect food. But for a cancer patient, they're not. Because they're high in fat. Saturated fat. Okay? So no avocados on the Gerson therapy. All right? This is a numbers game. This is what is the most efficient way to heal disease. Avocados are very healthy. Not for a cancer patient. No nuts and seeds. No strawberries. No pineapple. Why? They're high in aromatic acids. So is oregano. So is basil. So is curry. Okay? High in aromatic acids. Aromatic acids on a sick and dying liver are very volatile. Okay? So there's no nuts, seeds, pineapple, berries. Okay? Mushrooms. No mushrooms on the Gerson therapy. Eating mushrooms, like actually picking a mushroom and eating it. Gerson found that when he gave mushrooms to his patients, they didn't respond as well. Does anybody know why? Any idea why a mushroom might not be good to eat? A biological fungus. It's a fungus. How do fungi survive? In an anaerobic environment. An environment where there's no oxygen. That's how they survive. How does cancer survive? In an environment where there's no oxygen. So there must be some kind of a link there. And Gerson just didn't say, you know what, a mushroom's a fungi, so I don't think I'm going to get it. That's not how he came up with his ideas. He tried everything. For 50 years, he tinkered with every food, and he watched how bodies responded. That was part of his genius. So in his forbidden foods list, rest assured, it wasn't just some thought that came into his head. That's clinical, empirical observation. Okay? So nobody can compare to him to this day. He remains the greatest genius in medical history. Alright? So, there you go. Change your lives, folks. Stop eating all the garbage. Start pounding massive amounts of nutrition into your body. I guarantee you everybody in this room is depleted from years and years of abuse. Okay? I think we're going to do question and answer at the end, right?
We are.
Okay, good. Okay. First question in back.
Thank you, Patrick. I'm interested to know, because we have an innate endocannabinoid system, have you considered using cannabis juice in your juicing program?
Cannabis juice? Well, that would be illegal in Mexico, first of all.
But it's illegal everywhere. But the thing is, with the cannabis plant, it is not psychotropic, it's psychoactive. It's only when it's heated that the THC becomes psychoactive. So it's actually a vegetable. It has many, many cancer-fighting properties in that. So I just wondered whether you use that.
Well, I get that question a lot. And the way I answer it is this. If a chronic pot smoker comes to our clinic, we can't cure them of cancer. If somebody comes to our clinic with cancer and they've been smoking marijuana for the last, there is no line in the sand on this, but let's say the last 15, 20 years they've been smoking a joint a day. If they come to our clinic, we can't cure them. And the funny thing about them is that for 6 to 9 months, they respond amazingly well, as if we're curing them. And right around the 9th month, they fall off a cliff. Their immune system can only be rallied so much, because the THC in pot has killed off their central nervous system cells, which is their immune system. And so we can only rally their immune system so much, and then they fall off a cliff. So now today, there's out there cannabis, CBD oil, without THC. There's Rick Simpson oil, or Tim Simpson oil, I'm not sure what it's called, but and you know, apparently there's great testimonials for this stuff. But I just don't feel like using it, because it hasn't been tested that much in advanced cancer. There's actually a Facebook group doing Gerson and cannabis. And so I'm actually kind of watching that pretty closely to see how people are responding with cannabis and the Gerson therapy. But anybody who I've seen that's used CBD oil, it knocks their body out. I mean, it makes them so tired, and it really, to me, it stimulates their appetite, it helps with pain. But what I've noticed with people who do cannabis, and I don't know the various cannabis out there, like what he's speaking of, but I notice that when they do CBD oil in the United States, it knocks them out. And I'm not sure how good that is for the immune system. It's just, there's so many things out there that people are using for cancer. You know, so many testimonials using this or using that. We have the most time-tested, proven therapy in the world. And so I just don't see the need to be using cannabis or even hemp oil. People ask me about hemp oil. We've been using flax oil for years successfully. So I guess my theory at this point in regards to cannabis oil or hemp is that if it ain't broke, you don't fix it. And so that's where I'm at. I am at this point in our therapy. And I believe the other things that we've added are much, much more powerful than adding something like that.
So could I ask then, with your juicing program, what is the ratio between the vegetable and the fruits that you use?
Yeah.
Is there a ratio?
Yeah, that's a good question. First of all, our juicing protocol, 9 juices are carrot apple. Carrot or carrot apple. And we've now added lemon. We've added lemon to our pure carrot juices. So 4 carrot lemon, 5 carrot apple, and then we do 4 green juices. And those green juices, they get charred. They get 1 leaf of chard, 2 leaves, outer leaves of red cabbage. They get watercress. They get 1/4 of a green pepper, 1/2 of a Granny Smith apple, and Granny Smith specifically. Because Granny Smith is very high in malic acid. And in the Krebs cycle that I was telling you about, when sugar enters the mitochondria and goes through the Krebs cycle, that first reaction to get it going requires malic acid. So the apple a day does keep the doctor away. So malic acid is very high in Granny Smith apples. The sweeter apples, useless. Okay? So, but now we've added lemon. Gerson used to have lemon in his original juicing protocol. And then he changed it when a bunch of stuff came out in the literature about carrots and greens and this and that and Granny Smith apples. We've re-added lemon because a study came out about 1.5 years ago where they tested all these fruits against cancer and cancer cells. And they found that only 2 fruits stood out clearly amongst all the rest, clearly, as stopping cancer dead in its tracks. Lemons and cranberries. Lemons and cranberries. And so we've added lemons and cranberries into the Gerson protocol based on that study. So our patients are getting one lemon, essentially an ounce of lemon juice in their carrots, and then they're getting about 1/2 of a green Granny Smith apple in their other juices. So that's that.
Fantastic.
Next question? No, more questions. Yes?
For non-cancer patients, how is best to adapt the Gerson therapy at home to just have a very good optimum
diet?
So
she's asking what's the protocol for a non-cancer patient? A cancer patient's getting 13 juices a day, 5 coffee enemas a day, they're getting a full supplement protocol. A non-cancer patient can get away with about half that. 6, 7, 8 juices, 2, 3 enemas, and 1/2 of the supplement protocol. And typically a lot of those non-malignant diseases will resolve themselves within 6 to 9 months typically. Sometimes, depending how advanced they are, like an MS or something, that may take 12, 18 months, 2 years, depending on how severe. But so a non-malignant disease does essentially 1/2 the protocol, maybe a little bit more. So. Next question.
Can you give some ideas how you treat Hashimoto's disease?
No different. As I mentioned in the lecture, I can take 3-4 different types of diseases, put everybody on the same protocol, and we heal them. So it'd be no different. Go ahead.
Can you tell me what the source of your pancreatic enzymes are?
Yes. The pancreatic enzymes we're using now come from a company called, I think, Rocky Mount Formulas. I think it's Rocky Mount Formulas, but I can give you their phone number in the United States.
No, I mean, what's the makeup of them? What source of, are they plant-based or are they animal-based?
Oh, no. That pancreatin is animal-based, for sure. We do use a plant-based digestive enzyme as well, but the alpha chymotrypsin, that's animal-based. So, yeah.
How are you administering the custard oil?
What?
How are you administering the custard oil?
Our patients get, every other day, our patients get 2 tablespoons of castor oil orally, followed by 2 tablespoons of castor oil in their 10 o'clock enema. So and if you've had chemo, you cannot do castor oil. You can't do castor oil for at least 3 to 4 months because castor oil pulls out chemo so quickly from the cells that you could go into chemotoxic shock and it could be very harmful. So our patients who've had chemo, they can only do castor oil maybe 2 to 3 months, maybe 4 months after we've detoxified their body with coffee enemas, the juices and everything. So next question, yes.
Okay, I did used to drink coffee, but now it gives me palpitation. Can I still do the coffee enema?
You'd have to see. She asked, I drink coffee, and now it gives me palpitations in the heart. So she asked, can I do the coffee enema safely? I'm going to say yes, but you have to see where you're at. First of all, the coffee we use is not a drinking coffee. So it's not roasted as much. The caffeine content might not be as great. But you have to check. I mean, we do 32-ounce coffee enema, and in that 32-ounce of coffee is 3 tablespoons of coffee. So you might have to try half the dosage, you know? And that's why people come to our clinic. You have to come to our clinic so we can figure out where what your body can handle when you come, okay? I mean, that's because people are different that way. I said people aren't different, but they in that way they are. I mean, when you come to us, everybody's in a different state. So we have to see what your body can handle based on how much chemo you've had, based on how advanced the therapy is. So in your case with palpitations, maybe in the beginning you might feel a little bit, but I don't think you're going to feel as much as if you're drinking a full roasted, you know, cup of coffee. But anyway, that's something you just have to work with. Yeah?
Hi, you do screen measurements to get chlorophyll. Can you just take that liquid chlorophyll and get the same effect?
Well, what's the problem with liquid chlorophyll? It's in a bottle. Anything that's in a bottle, it's been either pasteurized or it's been broken down by, you know, time and air and heat and the bottling process. So you're best getting your chlorophyll from eating and drinking greens, ultimately, you know. But I'm sure it serves some purpose on some level, but it's not going to give you the maximum efficient healing capacity as, you know, a pure juice. Yes?
Is Gerson therapy working for brain tumors successfully?
The problem with it is this. With brain cancers, the way the body heals cancer is through inflammation. All right? Whenever you break a leg or you cut your finger, what happens? It gets inflamed, right? That's how the body heals. It starts sending inflammatory white blood cells to the area to clear up the problem. Well, when there's brain cancer, it's the same. When we're trying to heal a brain cancer, you've got to be very careful. Because if you stimulate too large an immune response and cause an inflammatory reaction in the brain, what do you think can happen? So the Gerson therapy with brain cancers, you have to tread very lightly with those. So yeah, we have to tread very lightly. You know, there's some things that are showing promise in brain cancers, like frankincense. Okay, taking frankincense orally, which we're doing now actually at our clinic as well. Our patients get 2 drops of frankincense every couple hours under the tongue or on the roof of the mouth, because that's showing promise as well in treating cancers. But in brain cancers in particular, it's showing some promise. But anyway, yeah, you gotta tread lightly with the Gerson therapy, because it is so powerful at healing, and the way it heals is through creating inflammation, creating a white blood cell response in the body. Yes, sir?
Can I ask you a non-medical question? The way you've been talking about the way that these large companies are forcing you to go kind of like into a different country to do your job to help humanity get over these diseases, do you see any time in the future, with the information that's out there now, that changing?
No, it's getting worse. I don't know if you know this, but 50 of my colleagues in the United States have been murdered or mysteriously gone missing in the last 8 to 10 months. Yeah, the more and more people like you get interested in natural therapies, the more they're losing control. And the more they're losing control, now it's become literally a war. And they're out there killing us. And yeah, they're literally out there killing us at this point. And so, and like, I know 2 people personally that are dead. And we don't know why they're dead. You know, Dr. Gonzalez, they say he died of a heart attack, but he was perfectly fine, you know? And he's, you know, I mean, he knows what he knows. He was very healthy. It wasn't like he's out there, you know, eating steaks and, you know, chips all day long. He practiced what he preached. And then a chiropractic colleague of mine, Dr. Holt, was also, you know, died suspiciously and suddenly. So, no, they're getting, the more people are getting onto natural therapies, the more radical and violent they're getting towards natural therapy. Because they've instituted laws against it, but you can't keep people from the information now on the internet when you do come across it. So you can institute so many laws, but your body's your body. Once you become 18 years old, those laws no longer apply to you. Mm-hmm. Anyway, yeah, go ahead.
Do you have a view on using bioelectric medicine for the increase of ATPs in the body?
Using what?
Bioelectric medicine.
Give me an example.
Using microcurrent technology to increase its demonstration.
We do it.
You do?
Yeah. We do it. I forgot to mention that. We're doing blood electrification, okay, to increase the oxygenation of the body. Our products come from a company in Canada called SOTA, SOTA.com, SOTA.com. They have a silver pulser, which puts in a 9 volt electric current into your bloodstream. And that's helping to oxygenate tissues better as well. They have a magnetic pulser. They have the water ozonator that she uses all 3 of those products. So do I. We have those at our clinic. So the answer is yes.
In this country, Orthodox medicine actually is quite not skeptical. It's very vague, but quite negative with regards to the use of bioelectric medicine with cancers. Could you tell me how you would answer that?
No, I don't have an answer for it other than we know that a healthy immune system, it's releasing electrical signals that can stun or actually kill off viruses, bacteria, cancer cells. So that's the one way that works. And again, the other way that works is it increases the body's oxygenation capacity, and we know that kills cancer. So those are the only 2 mechanisms that I know. That blood electrification or bioelectric therapies can kill off cancer, and that's what that's how the beamer mat's working as well. That beamer mat, it's releasing electromagnetic frequencies, healthy electromagnetic frequencies, not like cell phones and computers, which are very deadly electromagnetic frequencies. So anyway, yeah. Next question, right there.
Which frankincense oil can we ingest? Because there's a lot of different frankincense oil out there.
Well, I mean, you want to try to get an organic one, obviously. We use Oracacia organic, or you could use doTERRA organic. Those are the 2 that, you know, pretty much have the greatest reputations out there. But anyway, that's that. But anyway, real quick, our website is gersontreatment.com. Gersontreatment.com. My email, and it comes directly to me, so I answer you, is info@gersontreatment.com. info@gersontreatment.com. Our Facebook page, Northern Baja Gerson Center. Northern Baja Gerson Center. B-A-J-A. Baja. Baja California. Northern. Baja. Gerson. Center.
Email.
My website, gersontreatment.com. Email, info@gersontreatment.com. Simple. Last name, phone number, American phone number, 715-299-5070. 715-299-5070 is our American phone number. We're in Mexico, but our phone number is in the United States. So you can contact us anyway in those four ways right there. Through our website, email, phone number, Facebook. I guess no more questions.
Patrick, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Absolutely.